This program is about certain urban men and women who are homosexual. It is not about all homosexuals because their world is as diverse as a heterosexual world. It is not about those who are hiding their sexual preferences. It is told in the words of the participating lesbians and gay men in order to understand better their homosexual experience. They describe how they see themselves and what they believe to be important in their lives. Those who speak were chosen because they best reflect the views and concerns of the homosexuals we consulted. The program makes no attempt to consider the origins of homosexuality, nor does it make judgments about the lifestyles depicted. There is explicit material in this hour. Parental discretion is advised.
When I was asked to be in this film, I had to think rather carefully. My immediate response was, of course, I'd love to do it. But then everybody does have a career and a life and a future to think of. And mine could be very seriously jeopardized by this, by appearing on the film.
There are people that don't know that I'm gay, that will know now from this, family members, things like that, that I won't have any control over their reactions. I won't be sitting there with them saying, this is who I am, I'm a lesbian. Can I help you deal with that? You know, I won't have any control over those reactions.
Many of the people who know me in some fashion will probably know more about me from this film than they ever will have from our professional or private relationships. And that's a great exposure for me. That's not something that I offer recklessly or cavalierly. But I offer it in good faith and as an earnest challenge. I hope it'll be accepted in good faith as well.
Can you handle a secret? Naturally, as Oscar Goldman, director of the fictitious OSI, I can handle a secret, and so can these two remarkable friends of mine, Steve Austin and Jamie Summers. On television, access to secret material is mandatory for our jobs. And if the same applies to you, there are certain methods that must be observed if you're handling secret material. Any information designated as secret must be signed for when in use, when it's distributed, or when it's being disposed of. And when handling secret material, always use the cover sheet and always keep it within your sight. While it's not crucial for Steve, Jamie, or me to observe these precautions, it is imperative that you do. After all, we're only acting in the interests of a weekly television series. You're acting in the interests of national security.
Secret of gay oppression is despair. Every day when you get up in the morning, you put away your real self and you put on the mask of someone else which you wear.
No one's going to be in the closet, Mardi Gras Day. It's a joyful time. And it's a time to love.
Mardi Gras is a gay party and the biggest party in the world.
Anybody you want to be, you can let it right out of you. You hit the streets, wear your drag, and everybody in the world looks at you, and oh, this is wonderful.
Mardi Gras was a freedom for gay people before they had any freedom. They could come down here and just let their hair down. They could carry on. They could do anything they wanted to. People are going to love you. They're going to be kissing you in the street. They're going to be hugging you. You're going to get needs met, which you don't do every day.
This is a homosexual ghetto. A big part of the population is homosexual. I like my people around me, and I feel real safe here.
If I'm an expatriate from America and I live here in a place that's real good for my sort of person, then part of the reason I'm here is because the rest of society has sort of asked me to leave.
I was virtually asked to leave Indiana. I mean, nobody came out and said, go away to a big city, faggot. Nobody actually came out and said that, except I had to say it at one point when I was graduating from college. One professor put me in touch with another professor who wanted to talk to me in another building, and what did he want to talk about? I don't know. Just go over there and talk to this man, the dean of something or other. And as it came down, I was graduating from college and was going to go teach school, and I got the uncomfortable feeling that I knew what this appointment was about without anybody ever having said anything. And so I explained to him carefully and slowly and looked him right in the eye that, yeah, no, I wasn't going to stay in Terre Haute, Indiana. He didn't have to worry about his little darlings. I was going to go off to Chicago and be lost in a mass of people. And he sighed a sigh of relief and got right back to the bureaucracy of running whatever he was running. And that was one of the prices I paid. But I figured, I knew at that point I had to pay it. It was either that or they weren't going to graduate me from college or license me to teach school, because of obviously a child molester, there are no two ways about it.
Michael, why did you try to kill yourself?
That's way in the past. That's way in the past. It taught me a couple of things. Don't trust anybody. Size them up as they come through the door. And maybe you have eyes in the back of your head. You learn to live defensively. Yeah, from that experience, I learned a whole lot. It's a good thing I didn't die, and I genuinely wanted to die. It was towering around. It was just literally towering around me. There was no place else to go except just lay down and go to sleep, and then leave it at that. Because it had been mounting up to that point for years, ever since I was aware that I was sexual at all, or was wanted any kind of affection or companionship for anyone else. I had it in the back of my head, and they all had it in the back of their heads, apparently. There's something terribly wrong about this. They made me feel that way. And I don't feel that way, damn it. I feel like me. And I like me, pretty much. They can't hurt me in here, in these pictures. When I draw them, nobody can hurt me in there. There are pictures about waiting as much as there are pictures about being solitary or alone. Just the act of waiting is a vacuum. That horrible feeling you feel standing in a line eternally by yourself in a grocery store with all that anonymous life around you. And it's the crazy part in me just wants to scream at somebody that I don't know. Just grab somebody and hug them that I don't know them. And that's the part I don't do, because that's the part they lock me up for. But I think everybody wants to do that. You know, just you blow the whistle and say, yeah, all right, damn it, let's everybody here tell each other how much we really love each other, or could we love each other, or please, I mean, could we try? All you ever wanted was your parents to love you. That's all you ever wanted was people to accept you and love you. And you were told, you've been told in so many words, there's something in you that lacks the worth of love. Maybe go out and dig it up, or try to dig it up a little harder and faster, maybe, huh? I don't know.
I'm so happy with all of them.
If you're told all of your life to subscribe to a behavior and to conform and not let anybody know who you are, then you get one day of the year when you can let it rip. Oh, Tootsie, really. You can go out and all those people and show them who you are, who you want to be. And you don't have to be afraid of it. You don't have to hide it anymore.
This is my Mr. Macho. I want to hear a big round of applause.
Aren't they great? Happy morning, bro.
it's like to be lost and alone in the wasteland of America. How it feels to think you're the only one. You know, I'm the only one that feels this way. I really am queer. And to grow up with that, that pain of being different and constantly being put down for being different, for for not wanting to play football, and at the same time never being chosen to play football. You know, there's, you know, you're rejected, you're constantly rejected, you know, and that's particularly true of sissies, of people, of boys who grow up that don't fit the male image of what a little boy is supposed to do, a little boy is supposed to be. You know, I know that pain. I live with that pain all the time. There's years of toll that pain has taken on all of us. I think straight men are even somehow more terrified of the word sissy than gay men are. You know, and gay men are certainly terrified of the word. It's a term of terrorism that's held against any male child who doesn't conform. And I didn't conform. I never measured up to manly behavior. I never, never, never did. You know? And I always tried. I always tried. You know, sure, I wanted his approval. Every kid wants father's approval, you know? Parents' approval. I mean, these are the first people you grow up knowing. You know, and sure, we all want their approval. You know, and later that extended out to peers and school teachers and what have you. And after a while, you know, I'm 46 years old. After a while, I just said, to hell with it. I'm never going to do it. I'm never going to do it. You know, I will never be the man that this society wants me to be. And I don't want to be. I don't want to be anymore. But sure, I spent a lot of years trying to do that, trying to be a man.
When you're growing up and you come out at an early age, and you decide you want to tell your parents, you know, that you're gay. In a Puerto Rican family or in a black family, this is not what a man is supposed to be like.
You go in the street, you try to be gay, what's left to you? 42nd Street, 3rd Avenue, 53rd.
My father, in the way he is, telling him I'm gay, his resolution to the problem, you know, leave. Get that out of here, you're no longer a son of mine. There's no such thing as a Puerto Rican gay. It's a Puerto Rican man, and that's the end of that.
When I was growing up, when I was like 15 years old, I told my mother I was gay. But she didn't accept it right away, and she sent me to a reformatory.
Being gay means that you want to be a woman. You're just a mistake. You're an error, something that's even beyond God.
It started with your mother. Your own mother, you know.
They either sweep it under the rug, or they totally throw you out and forget that you were born.
She didn't have to put me away. That's the only problem. I'm a human just like everybody else.
What's the matter, Rob?
A lot of them go through the groups, and you go on and go on and go on, but once you go back out there into that world again, once again, you have to fight. In gay life, they get thrown into and eaten up alive because they're so hungry, they're so desperate for love, for some concern. I took it out on myself. I went ahead and made love to everybody, anybody and everybody I could meet. I would spend nights in and out of the parks, from Central Park to Riverside Park, down to Broadway, over to 3rd Avenue. Sometimes I would turn tricks and not even charge them. I just wanted to be loved. But some of the pain that I've gone through and some of the experiences I've been through, they wasn't really necessary. They weren't necessary. Who knows, I might have opted out to this being my only alternative, you know, if someone at home would have. Not a psychiatrist. You don't need a bunch of degrees. You just need to sit down and listen to them. When, you know, when a kid feels certain feelings, listen to them. You know, and if real feelings are coming from a human being, respect them. and teach them values and convictions just like anyone else gets in this society.
People are in small towns. That's where we all come from.
Everybody knows your business. Everybody knows what you're doing.
I thought I was the only 15-year-old girl who thought she was gay.
You really don't belong anywhere because you don't have anything in common with any of these people.
You couldn't find yourself there with three or four other people. Because when you only know three other gay people, you can't even afford to fight with them because they're the only people you can even be out to.
All I know was I wanted to escape.
Running away from home. And coming out of the closet, to me, it was like being born. I finally felt free.
I was like a balloon that had suddenly been released into the sky.
I just went wild. I said, oh, my God, all these women, and they're all gay, and oh, I love it. I was just, like, so overcome.
It was shiny and bright and orange and colorful.
You can do anything you want. You can get lost here, or you can become the queen of the city if you'd like.
And it was vibrant, and there was a lot of feeling, a lot of flavor, you know, a lot of noise. It was alive.
Having this fantasy in your mind of a place that you can come and finally be all right in and come and still be your regular self with all the pain and despair and need and desperation that you had in other places, and not necessarily any closer to the answers.
I came to the city knowing that there was a lot more freedom. It was an overwhelming experience opening that door and walking into a woman's bar in 1969 in New York City. And to have the response of women approaching me and talking to me and actually sitting there throughout the evening relating to lesbians. I mean, there's, for me at that point, there was something so, I mean, these were the women that were kept away from me. These were the women that were denied from me. These were the women whom I certainly, at that point, had not given up the idea that these women were freaks, outlaws, outside the defined, you know, the defined role or whatever, the, you know, the defined status. I certainly see that, I feel ambivalent about it because on the one hand, I see them as, I see bars as a fact of our existence, a part of our daily life, but also playing into the very real oppression of our lives. You know, I knew that I loved women, and that's not something that I was permitted to truly know. And that takes an incredible amount it takes an incredible toll. Because we're not, you see, what we're not talking about, I'm not talking about oppression and liberation in terms of civil rights or jobs or having a roof over my head. Those things are certainly important. But I'm talking about something far more essential, something far more basic. You know, the right to be, the right to be oneself.
When I came to San Francisco, my life changed completely. Everybody here was doing what they wanted to do and being free and open and loving, and you couldn't do that in a small town back east. It was all, oh, go meet somebody in the toilet of the railroad station. I mean, that's what they were putting there, degrading you and putting you down to, that's where you belong. I went through a period of anonymous sex. I did it when I first came to the city. Back rooms, parks where you didn't even meet the person, didn't even ask the person's name. Just sex. But I didn't feel good, I mean, at all. For so long, it's been hidden that now they can be open and they can have it and they can do it, that everybody's out there doing it. And it's so available. And there's no more hiding anymore. It's just there and it's for the taking. And if you want it, you take it. And you can have it. And It's wonderful, yeah. It's really wonderful. I like it. But you can get caught up in it, too. And we're at the point where you don't have any other life, and you're just out there, which happened to me for a long time. I did that for several years. To the point now where, no, I won't, you know, I'll go down to Castle Street, you know, used to be every day. I go down once a week, you know, once, you know, it's not that, I don't have that hunger anymore. But it is out there. I can't say I don't have the hunger anymore. I still have it. You can't, it's still there. When there's all those men there, and you know, it's like being in a candy store. You know, which one do I want? I'll pick him and him and him. There it is. It's there. Yeah, I still have it. I want to kid myself and think I don't have it. I do. There. It'll always be there. Always be in this city. It's a beautiful city.
See the same men out there day after day looking and I think, what are they looking for? Or maybe they're not seeing. They're looking right at it. They don't see it. I see a lot of men who seem very lonely to me, who don't relate well to each other, and who are judging each other always by that image and the masculine look. And I suppose on how they perform in bed, I don't know. I don't know.
Castro Street says about men generally in our culture?
I think I think the overkill situation sexually of always being obsessed with sex, of being always having to perform sexually, of having to, I remember when I was growing up listening to boys talk about girls and thinking, God, I wonder if they talk, you know, I wonder how they would feel if somebody started talking about them that way, like they're a thing instead of a person. Human being. They talk about their girls and their women like they're keeping score. You know, like it's a collection. They've got a stamp collection. They've got a collection of fine-looking girls and beautiful women. And I find that the gay men do the same thing. And I can't say all gay men do that. I know a lot of them don't. I know I don't, and I'm not that unique. A lot of gay men don't relate that way. But on Castro Street, I think they do. A lot. Also, I'm very aware that there's a lot of men, and I don't think I would say gay men, but men are trained to be aware of status from an early age. It's part of our training, and I think that carries over into gay life. I think that you want to be seen with the most attractive person. You want to score sexually with the most attractive person. And you skim over the surface of a lot of issues, and you don't get into the depth, which, to me, brings me back to relating to men on a very personal level. For me, I had to throw out the strong, silent image. I had to throw out the unfeeling image, the unemotional image. I had to get rid of that. Because I'm not. I'm not any of those things. And then when I started pulling in what I was going to be, I finally decided at one point that I wanted to be pretty much what I was, but articulate. And to integrate the parts so that I could feel and express it. I could care about people and express it. I could be intimate with men. Tell them so, And it was very difficult to do that. But I think that for me to redefine male would be to say it's okay to feel, it's okay to be emotional, it's okay to touch, it's okay to hold, it's okay to support. Men, I think, don't know how to support each other. I don't think they know how. I think the women are way ahead of the game on that. I think because of the feminist movement, I think women are learning how to support each other in non-sexual ways. I think the men haven't begun. I don't think they've even begun. I think we're just becoming aware of the fact that we have a whole area of exploration to take apart, and that's the area of relating to each other on a really intimate basis. It's a human issue to me. It's how human beings relate to each other as human beings.
Had been together, I guess, 5 years, and rented a house for 4, and just in terms of feeling that I didn't have to worry about forever and ever anymore in terms of a relationship. In fact, I didn't worry at all about the relationship. I guess that's why it was the best time to buy the house. Pat understands how I feel. She understands a lot of my emotions and my vulnerabilities, and she understands when I feel like crying, and she can hold me. I can hold her. We can share that. We're sharing menopause right now, which I hope you remember how good I'm being to you, because my time's coming. And I don't think I can get that. So the very homoerotic nature of it is the strength of it for me.
For many gay men, there seems to be a split between intimacy and sexuality. Is that true for gay women as well?
Okay, well, let me first say what homophobic is. I hate to use a big word, but just let me put it in real simple terms of self-hatred for loving another person of the same sex. So if you have that, if you were to become really close to that person, then you would have to consider it to be a viable, real relationship. If you were to keep it on a very sexual level and sexualize the relationship, then you don't have to deal with it in a moral sense, that is, in an ethical sense. You can deal with it in a sexual way, linear, from point A to point B, and it doesn't have to go anywhere else. So to be in a sexual and intimate relationship implies closeness, acceptance, vulnerability, friendship, growth. And if you were to do that, then you couldn't be homophobic.
You'd have to use that horrible word, commitment.
You'd have to use that horrible word, commitment, and you would have to be in a position of loving someone like you. So the split is a reflection of the internal hatred. You know, how can the relationship work? When you hate what you're doing, when you hate yourself, when you hate the very act that symbolizes that, quote, love and intimacy. You have to do something with that. You have to sexualize it. You have to change it. You have to make it non-intimate. Make it sexual, and then it's all right. You know, I don't know if that would help you understand it anymore, but it's almost as if it's not allowed. Because if it were allowed, then the relationship would be healthy and all right. And how could you be healthy if you're queer?
Buying the house came to us at a time where we were working on getting together the sexuality and the intimate part of our relationship, too, because we, too, had that split. I mean, I think everybody has that. And that's what happens when relationships bust up after 2 years, because you have to that decision, and it's a real hard job.
Right.
Do you think that gay men and lesbians know something that straight men and women do not about how men and women should relate?
Well, the work that I do with heterosexual couples, that's very much a problem within their relationship, is the emerging role of the woman and the man's, you know, wanting to have the ability to be soft and to have some things that his role has not allowed him to. And in that way, we are the mirrors, and they certainly can learn a lot from us and from our struggles, because we've had to do that.
We've already done it.
We've had to do that from the beginning of our relationship to who's going to make the first move, who's going to ask whom to dance,
that's right.
Who's going to ask who to go to the movie.
Just the whole issue of being who you are and being okay with that is the thing. And heterosexuals are unfortunately much more confined by that training, I think, than we, because we have been forced to break out of that.
Yeah. It can't work any other way. So we do mirror heterosexuals. We can give them a great gift if they just look and not laugh or condemn.
I've spent a lot of time wanting my life back, wanting to recapture things in myself that I think are beautiful, that I've had to take apart and examine and despise. The desire to hold another woman and to be held by another woman is something that's absolutely a forbidden thought. There are a lot of gay suicides, and they come from that sense of not being able to clue into the thing that's the most critical in your life. I lost the most important relationship to a woman in my life because we had to come out. We finally had to make that choice to come out because we'd been in the closet for 5 years. And when we were confronted with that, she couldn't deal with it. She had to say, look, I've lost two women lovers already who committed suicide when we were discovered as gay. I can't live through that again. I can't stand to see what's going to happen to us because of it. I can't do it. I have to break up with you. That doesn't exactly make you able to move toward a lover in a very complete way. You're damaged. And so you carry that damage with you in your love, in the way that you love someone, and your fear. And that's never good for a relationship, ever.
You know, sometimes I wonder as to why, at age 50, I suddenly went over the fence. Maybe it was just that sense that I had only so many years left, and I needed to find out what I was. I was completely at sea. I didn't know quite what else you went to. The nuclear family was the way everybody lived. When I finally came out, I found myself caught up in a perfectly delightful series of relationships that I just didn't know were possible or existed. Responsibilities were not thrust on you. I did my best to be a success object. I did my best to fulfill the expectancies that my mother and father had of me. And all of a sudden, here I am, and it's nothing.
You've been married twice. Many affairs, countless girlfriends. What are the erotic and emotional differences for you in a relationship with a man and a woman?
I don't think there's much erotic difference between relationship with a man and a woman and a man and a man. Certainly Masters and Johnson's emphasized that point. It's not, for me, necessarily erotic. It is a relationship, on the one hand, which implies the expectancies of family, establishment, responsibility, and so forth and so on, can kill. And the eroticism which expresses equality, which expresses non-expectancy, which has a kind of a playful joy about it, and, you know, okay, let's go. I mean, there's no tomorrow to it, even though there may be a great many tomorrows, and I've had great many tomorrows in gay relationships. Still, that moment, that instant, doesn't have all these reverberations that it has when you sleep with a woman. With a woman, regardless of whether you were married or not married, and infidelity was not unknown to me, the implication was that it was going to go on and on and on, and there you saw the next bunch of children in the next house in the country and the next this and the next that. And it was a turnoff to me, which is not to say that I haven't taken responsibilities in both heterosexual and homosexual relationship. It simply means that I don't like to be shoved into it and have that implicit feeling that there is another set of shackles waiting out there for you.
Father John and I met 20 years ago.
In a sense, I think we are like the same person. We almost have the same thoughts and the same wavelengths. Gay people are much more likely to be realistic about themselves and their sexuality. The sexual freedom and absence of jealousy enhanced and enriched our erotic lives.
There was a period in my life where I needed to experience and explore more of the world around me to find out what it was like. Call it a very late period in life to sow one's wild oats.
You are taught that sexual fidelity is of the utmost importance, and that the other person is destroyed and should be penalized and cast away just because they've had sex with someone else. What he does with his sexuality is unimportant as long as he's happy. But every other kind of part of him and my love and concern for him are of the utmost importance. Do you know, faithfulness on every other level is far more important than the simple fact of who he's in bed with. And this is hard to understand at first.
The body and blood of Christ. We love each other. We're in love. We have been, and it appears we will continue to be, God willing.
America is stronger than you think. Our strength lies in our people. We can meet today's challenges and provide energy for tomorrow. We have abundant potential resources of coal, oil, and natural gas. What we need is the will to develop them and the determination to conserve the energy we have. So next time someone says this nation lacks the strength and energy to be great, think about it. When it comes to energy, America is stronger than you think.
Where there is absolutely no competition going on.
for a group of men to be non-competitive is really something. And in this group, where it's a group of gay men and lesbians, healing is one of sharing and support. Now defining our culture as a visible culture, and we're defining it in positive terms rather than negative terms, which is what we've done most of our lives. We're going to be able to define it in positive terms, what we can do, the ways we do want to relate.
I think that homosexuals may be particularly high in kinesthesia, being able to imagine what it is to be shot, or imagine what it is to be such and such, being able to feel as others feel.
Turn your head a little bit. No, thank you.
We all are painfully inadequate in one way or another, either psychologically or physically. And usually it's those ideas that I want to express. And I think that's very important, to create from unhappy ideas. More important art frequently comes from unhappy realizations. I don't think there is any way that I would paint with the intensity, with the caring, with the patience to go on redoing and doing, working the things, figuring out the problems. I don't think there's any way I could have gone through all this time painting about people and their problems unless I was homosexual. I just don't think. I think that in history, most of the intense people painters have been homosexual. Because you know about worrying about your acceptance, about your shape, your look. You know about other people's problems. You just sense it, feel it. You just know it. Empathy, sympathy and compassion, endurance, are highly intensified by your knowing the real hell of feeling on the outside of things.
I think that there is a certain privilege to adversity. Out of that great hardship is born self-knowledge. So in that sense, I think that homosexuals in the avant-garde of human awareness. I'm studying to be a psychoanalyst. I hope to be able to help people heal themselves, to help them translate their own inner voices so that they know the language of their own growth. I don't think I would have any of the sort of capacity, as nascent as it is now, for listening and understanding, if I hadn't been through analogous adversity myself, if I hadn't, by virtue of the fact of experiencing my own conflicts and battles with myself, been able to begin to heal myself and to know what it means to want to be whole. Now I think I can be of use to other people.
There's something rather comforting in being surrounded by one's own dreams. In a way, that room is like a ship. You notice it is all wood. This room is full of the sea, the shells and the colors and the the moving ball which makes starlight on the walls. I love the sea and I love living on the edge of the sea. And I think my dream world, which is very, very real to me, moves in time and place. I think that's what the dream world is about, getting away from this harsh, fluorescent lit plastic world into worlds of other times and places where I feel happier. I realized when I was very small, when I was perhaps 3 years old, that I was different from other people. I didn't have a name for it then. The word homosexual was a forbidden word. I never heard it until I was 15 years old. And as I grew from being a toddler to a child, I became more and more isolated because of it. And I think this kind of isolation fosters creativity. And certainly I became very creative, and I spent my whole time when I was growing up, when I was a little boy, painting and dreaming and writing and dreaming and playing with making dolls' houses and dreaming about them. And so I got into the habit of working, into the habit of writing, painting very early on. So that it's now my way of life. I think one is forced to be very much more aware of oneself. I think when you move in a world where you are accepted, the tensions, the everyday tensions are flaccid. For us, the everyday tensions are always tight and immediate. I think one lives on the edge of one's life. So I think if you're a gay person, certainly when I grew up, if you were a gay person, life was much more brilliant. It was as though it's the feeling that you have in Total War. You live as though you are at a party, because any second the bomb may fall. So you have this heightened awareness, this heightened urgency for living, heightened delight in living, because you are constantly at war with your surroundings, or threatened by your surroundings. You know, you never sink back into being a comfortable person in a grey mass of people. You are always the one on whom they may turn at any moment. But I feel the world is changing, and I think that those values are dying away, and hopefully real human values are taking their place. Women, men, androgynous boys, Diesel Dykes, we are all people first. And as people, we can relate to each other and love each other and hug each other, be close, become one. And that, of course, is what ought to be.